What's up, folks? It's Coach Ty back at you with another one, and today we've got our quadricep guide. So as usually, Jesus Christ. As usual, we've got the anatomy, the volume based on the fiber typing, and my exercise selection. So here we go. Let's get into the anatomy. Of course, the quadriceps have four heads, the vastus lateralis, the vastus intermedius, and the vastus medialis. Your fourth head is your rectus femoris. Now, the rectus femoris is the only one of the quadricep heads which attaches at your hip. The other three heads only attach at the knee. Now, you can use the names to know where the muscle sits. So, lateralis, as always, means lateral, outside of the body. Intermedius, middle. Medialis means center or midline of the body. So your vastus medialis is that little teardrop muscle on the inside of your quad, and the rectus femoris, which is again a little bit different, is the one that goes straight from your knee all the way up to your hip, straight down the middle. Now all four heads work in conjunction to extend your knee, but the rectus femoris also is a hip extensor. So the rectus femoris can also be trained using hip flexion movements. However, because the rectus femoris plays a role in hip flexion, that means its antagonist role is hip extension. So when you're performing a move in which you have knee extension and hip extension, like a squat, the rectus femoris will only play a very minor role. I did not at any point say that the quadricep acts on hip rotation. So you may have seen or heard people making the claim that if you point your toes outward, that you're gonna train the outside of the quads, and if you point your toes inward, then you're gonna train the teardrop, so on and so forth, or that if you perform a split squat versus a normal squat will hit the vastus medialis, or this exercise will help you get the teardrop, this exercise for the teardrop, this exercise for the teardrop. It's not the case. Now again, the rectus femoris is the different muscle in the quadriceps. In combined hip and knee extension moves like the squat, lunge, Bulgarian split squat, normal split squat, step up, so on and so forth, the rectus femoris has very poor leverage to do anything, so it's largely inactive. So we need to make sure in our exercise selection that we have a move in which your hips are extended. If your hips are extended while you're extending your knees, then the rectus femoris has much better leverage to operate from. So for quadricep moves, we're gonna have two main categories. One will be a push kind of exercise. So again, squat, lunge, step up, so on and so forth, something from that category. And your second category will be a knee extension move in which your hips are extended. So a reverse Nordic curl would count, a sissy squat would count, or a standing leg extension would count. We do know that the quadricep can experience stretch-mediated hypertrophy from the research. So we also wanna make sure we have a movement in there for that purpose. The exercises that I named a little bit earlier, the ones for the rectus femoris, count. So basically we kill two birds with one stone by having a movement in which the hips are already extended or are extended for the entire movement, and we extend our knee against resistance. Moving on to my volume recommendation. And we're gonna talk fiber typing, of course, but I wanna introduce you to a new concept called voluntary activation. Voluntary activation is defined as the level of neural drive to muscle during exercise. Put more simply, how well your nervous system can activate a particular muscle. Now, the quadriceps have very low voluntary activation. Now, this is another concept that we need to consider in regards to our volume recommendation, meaning it is less likely to sustain damage during exercise. Now, for the fiber typing, there's a very wide variety of fibers from slow to fast within the quadriceps. So essentially what all this means is your quadriceps, you can throw the kitchen sink at them. You can do lots of volume and very high frequency on your quadriceps and they will recover just fine. The quadriceps recover more quickly than most, if not all, of your other muscles. So again, do as much as you want. And oftentimes in practice, you may see people with gigantic quads are usually Olympic lifters and power lifters who are training their quads with heavy weight constantly. 4 or 5 times a week, they're hitting their quadriceps with heavy amounts of weight, and the quads blow up. Another group that we will oftentimes see have gigantic quads are cyclists. Now, why is this? Simply because they are constantly using their quadriceps with the high amount of biking that they're doing. And every time on a bike you push, you extend your knee, that's knee extension, so the quadriceps are responsible there. And again, the quadriceps recover extremely quickly, so the high amount of reps and volume that a cyclist is doing will blow their quadriceps up. So my recommendation for your quadriceps will be anywhere between 3 and 5 sets per session, 3 to 5 times per week. And because of the wide range of fiber typing in the quadriceps, we can do everything from 3 to 15 reps. It's largely all going to be valuable, although I would err towards the middle in there. I would base the rep range that I'm using on the movement that I'm doing. If I'm doing a push, I would err towards the lower end, so squats, lunges, so on and so forth. I would go a little bit heavier, maybe somewhere between 4 and 10. And for my single joint movements, my leg extensions, my sissy squats, so on and so forth, I would go a little bit higher, more like 8 to 15. Moving on to our exercise selection. So my first move for you, the heels up back squat. Now, I always prefer doing most of my lower body pushing movements with my heels elevated because of my proportions. There is no shame in elevating your heels so you can get a longer range of motion at your knee. And of course, the longer the range of motion at the knee, the better it is for your quadriceps. As a matter of fact, I was going to just kind of skip past this point, but I think it's extremely important because I see people being very confused on this. So I'm gonna kick over to Tom Purvis, who explains flawlessly why your different proportions make such a massive difference in your squat mechanics, and therefore, for the purpose of this video, your knee range of motion and your ability to get very low on squats and blow your quads up. Over to Tom.
If their trunk is short, it makes it even worse. If someone's trunk was so short that they had to put the weight roughly right here, they are bent forward and all they feel is low back and all they feel is hip. If, by contrast, you had someone with proportionally shorter femur, proportionally longer floor to knee, and proportionally longer torso in terms of where they can put the weight, this person could fold up, sit all the way down, and they have no idea why anybody thinks squatting is difficult. This person feels quads more than anything else. Halfway down looks like this to them. This is not getting fatigued because it's not all perpendicular to the ground. Totally different thing. So look again at the extremes. Here is an optimum squatting proportion. And of course, if you don't have any dorsiflexion, it still messes with you. So all of these factors are interdependent. But if I were to have a short trunk or put the bar really low, and a proportionally long femur, and a proportionally short tibia, this person hates squats.
Bulgarian split squat. Now, this exercise has actually been compared in the research to the normal squat, and interestingly enough, induces the same amount of muscle activity as a back squat, but while using far less weight. You also get a really great stretch in that back leg, and as we talked about a little bit earlier, stretching that quadricep is great for growth. Next move, the hack squat. Now again, I love the hack squat because I can get a much longer range of motion at my knee joint. I can just sit much lower than I would otherwise be able to on a normal squat. Move your feet a little bit lower on the pad, let your knees track all the way forward, and again, you'll be able to get a much longer range of motion at your knees. For all my short kings and queens out there, I like to add yoga blocks onto the pads, which again, lets me get a much longer range of motion. Because I'm pretty short, I always hit the bottom of a hack squat. Add these on and that'll give you an extra few inches of range of motion so you can really get those hamstrings touching your calves. Bodyweight sissy squat. Take your hand or your arm, place onto something for balance. Push your knees forward while keeping your hips extended. and this goes into our rectus femoris slash stretch mediated hypertrophy category. Leg extension, similar thing. Now, I would strongly suggest you put the pad all the way back on a leg extension, the back pad. This will let you lean all the way back, extending your hips a little bit more and letting you stretch the quadricep much more than you would otherwise be able to. Now, I put all these exercises together, all these sissy squats, because you need a sissy squat bench in order to perform them. I would strongly encourage you to grab one. They're not that expensive over on Amazon, and they will help your quads blow up because it's all knee extension and also because it's a closed chain exercise. You may have seen in a previous video, which I'll link, that closed chain exercises perform better for growth and strength gain than their open chain counterparts. And this is a closed chain leg extension. This is a progression, adding a dumbbell. And for the next progression, I'm gonna kick over to previous tie. Okay, so our next progression will be using a band. So you need to find a low point to anchor your band to. So we're gonna use this cable stack here. And the next, step into the band. Walk on out. Get set up on your sissy squat bench. Now, the great thing about this is the band is pulling you backwards. So as you perform the squat, you have to extend your knees against that band. So this is actually the variation or the progression that I feel the most in my quadriceps when performing this. It's also got really nice accommodating resistance because as you go back, the band gets less taut and easier. And then as you extend, it's more and more taut. So that extension at the top, whereas usually you wouldn't have any tension on the quads up here, because this is pulling you backwards, you get a really hard contraction up here at the top. So the band is actually my favorite progression to use with the sissy squat. Thank you, previous tie. And for our last exercise, again, I haven't decided exactly what to call this, but I'm gonna just call it the matrix sissy squat for the sake of this discussion.
He's beginning to believe.
You don't need to do what I'm doing here necessarily. Just try to get your hips more extended than they would otherwise be, and keep trying to get your hips a little more extended. Again, what this is gonna do is lengthen your quads to a massive degree, help you stretch those quads out, and blow them bad boys up. All right, folks, thank you guys for listening and watching. As always, please like, comment, subscribe, and share. I've got two more videos in the corners for you now. Please check those out when you can, and let me know what you want to hear from me next. I am here for you. I'll see you with the next one. Deuces.